holographic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Morning Star, Book 3 of the Red Rising Saga, Part 2, by Pierce Brown. Narrated by Stewart Crank. And performed by a full cast.
The sky is the color of blood underneath a dead nail as we fly away from the spires. This time, we are imprisoned, chained, belly down to the back of fetid fur saddles like luggage. My eyes water as the wind of the lower troposphere slashes into them. The griffin beats its wings, muscled shoulders rippling, churning the air. We bank sideways, and I see the riders tilting their masked faces up to the sky to see the faint light that is Phobos. Little flashes of white and yellow mar the darkening sky as ships overhead battle. I pray silently for Severo's safety, for Victorus and the Howlers. Words failed with Alia, as Mustang said they would. And now we are bound for Asgard, a gift for the gods to secure the future of her people. That is what she told Sefi. And her silent daughter took my chains, and with the help of Alia's personal guards, dragged me and Mustang and Holiday to the hangar, where her Valkyrie waited. Now, hours later, we pass over a land created by wrathful gods in their youth. Dramatic and brutal, the Antarctic was designed as punishment and a test for the ancestors of the Obsidians who dared rise against the Golds in the 200th year of their reign. A place so savage, less than 60% of Obsidians reach adulthood per board of quality control quotas. That desperate struggle for life robs them of a chance for culture and societal progress, just as the nomadic tribes of the first Dark Ages were so robbed. Farmers make culture. Nomads make war. Subtle signs of life freckle the bald waste. Roving herds of auroch, fires on mountain ridges, glittering from the cracks in the great doors of obsidian cities that are carved into the rock as they gather supplies and huddle behind their walls on the eve of the long dark of winter. We fly for hours. I fall in and out of sleep, body exhausted, not having closed my eyes since we shared the pasta with Ragnar in our cozy hole in the belly of that dead ship. How has so much changed so quickly? I wake to the bellow of a horn. Ragnar is dead. It's the first thought in my head. I am no stranger waking to grief. Another horn echoes as Sefi's riders close their gaps, drifting together into tight formation. We rise amidst a sea of ash-gray clouds. Sefi bent over the reins in front of me, pushing her griffin hard toward a hulking darkness. We slip free of the clouds to find Asgard, hanging in the twilight. It's a black mountain, ripped from the ground by the gods, and hung halfway between the abyss and the ice world below. Seat of the Aesir. Where Olympus was a bright celebration of the senses, this is a brooding threat to a conquered race. A set of stone stairs, precarious and seemingly unsupported, rises from the mountains, tethering Asgard to the world below. The Way of Stains. The path all young Obsidian must take if they wish to gain the favor of the gods, to bring honor and bounty to their tribes by becoming the servants of all Mother Death. Bodies litter the valley of the fallen beneath. frozen mounds of men and women, in a land where carrion never rots, and only the industry of crows can make proper skeletons. It is a lonely walk, and one we must make if the obsidian are to approach the mountain. This is what it takes to make an obsidian afraid. I feel that fear now from Sephi. She has never walked this path. No stained may stay among the people of the Spires or the other tribes. All are chosen by the Golds for service. Her mother never would have let her take the tests. She needed one daughter to remain as her heir. Unlike Olympus, Asgard is surrounded by defensive measures. Electronic, high-pitched frequency emitters that would make the Griffin's eardrums bleed two clicks out. A high-charged pulse shield closer in that would hyper-oscillate the molecular structure of any man or creature by boiling the water in our skin and organs. Black magic to the obsidian. But the sensors are dead today. Compliments of Quicksilver and his hackers. And the cameras and drones that monitor our approach are blind to us, showing instead the footage recorded 3 years before, just as with the satellites. There is only one way to seek an audience with the gods, and that is along the Way of Stains, through the Shadow Mouth Temple. We set down atop the forbidding mountain peak beneath Asgard, where the Way of Stains is tethered to the earth. A black temple squats over the stairs like a possessive old crone, its skin ravaged by time, face crumbling to the wind. I'm pulled off the saddle and fall to the ice, legs asleep after the long journey. The Valkyrie wait for me to rise with Mustang's help.
I think it's time.
I nod and let the Valkyrie push us after Sephi toward the black temple. Wind pours through the mouths of 333 stone faces that scream out from the temple's front facade, imprisoned beneath the black rock. Wild eyes desperate for release. We enter under the black arch. Snow rolls across the floor.
Sephi?
The woman turns slowly back to look at me. She's not cleaned her brother's blood from her hair.
May I speak to you? Alone?
The Valkyrie wait for their quiet leader to nod, before pulling Mustang and Holiday back. Sephi walks farther into the temple. I follow as best I can in my chains to a small courtyard open to the sky. I shiver at the cold. Sephi watches me there, in the weird violet light, waiting patiently for me to speak. It's the first time it's occurred to me that she's as curious of me as I am of her. And it also fills me with confidence. Those small, dark eyes are inquisitive. They see the cracks in things. In men. In armor. In lies. Mustang was right about Alia. She would never listen. I suspected it before we entered her throne room, but I had to give it my best. And even if she had listened, Mustang would never trust Alia Snowsparrow to lead the Obsidian in our war. I would have gained an ally and lost another. But Sephi... Sephi is the last hope I have.
Where do they go? Have you ever wondered? The men and women your clan gives to the gods. I don't think you believe what they tell you. That they are lifted up as warriors. That they are given untold riches in service of the immortals.
I wait for her to reply. Of course, she does not. If I can't sway her here, then we're as good as dead. But Mustang thinks, as do I, that we have a chance with her. More than we ever did with Alia, at least.
If you believed in the gods, you would not have sworn yourself to silence when Ragnar ascended. Others cheered. But you wept. Because you know, don't you?
I step closer to the woman. She's just above my own height, more muscular than Victra. Her pale face is nearly the same shade as her hair.
You feel the dark truth in your heart. All who leave the ice become slaves.
Her brow furrows. I try not to lose my momentum.
Your brother was stained, a son of the spires. He was a titan, and he ascended to serve the gods but was treated no better than a prized dog. They made him fight in pits, Seffi. They wagered on his life. Your brother, the one who taught you the names of the ice and wind, who was the greatest son of the spires in his generation, was another man's property.
She looks up at the sky, where the stars blink through the black, violet twilight. How many nights has she looked up and wondered what had become of her big brother? How many lies has she told herself so she can sleep at night? Now, to know the horrors he suffered, it makes all those times she looked at the stars so much worse.
Your mother was the one who sold him. She sold your sisters, brothers, your father. Everyone who has ever left has gone to slavery, like my people. You know what the prophets your brother sent said. I was a slave, but I have risen against my masters. Your brother rose with me. Ragnar returned here to bring you with us, to bring your people out of bondage. And he died for it, for you. Do you trust him enough to believe his last words? Do you love him enough?
She looks back to me, the whites of her eyes red with an anger that seems to have been long dormant, as if she's known of her mother's duplicity for years. I wonder what she's heard, listening for 2.5 decades. I wonder even if her mother has told her the truth. Seffi is to be queen. Perhaps that is the rite of passage, passing down the knowledge of their true condition. Perhaps Seffi even listened to our audience with Alia. Something in the way she watches me makes me believe this.
Seffi, if you deliver me to the Golds, their reign continues, and your brother will have sacrificed himself for nothing. If the world is as you like it, then do nothing. But if it is broken, if it is unjust, take a chance. Let me show you the secrets your mother has kept from you. Let me show you how mortal your gods are. Let me help you honor your brother.
She stares at the snow as it drifts across the floor, lost in thought. Then, with a measured nod, she pulls an iron key from her riding cloak and steps toward me. The stairs of the Way of Stains are frigid and gusty, and switch back devilishly into the sky through the clouds. But they are just stairs. We climb them without chains, in the guise of Valkyrie, bone riding masks painted blue, riding cloaks, and boots too big for my feet. All loaned to us by 3 women who stayed behind to guard the griffin at the base of the temple. Seffi leads us, 8 other Valkyrie coming behind. My legs shake from exertion by the time we reach the top and see the black glass complex of the Golds that crests the floating mountain. There are 8 towers in all, each belonging to one of the gods. They surround the central building, a dark glass pyramid, like wheel spokes, connected by thin bridges 20 meters above the uneven, snowy ground. Between us and the Gold complex is a 2nd temple in the shape of a giant, screaming face. This one as large as Castle Mars. In front of the temple lies a little square park, at the center of which stands a gnarled black tree. Flames smolder along its branches. White blossoms perch amidst the flames, untouched by the fire. The Valkyrie whisper to each other, fearing the magic at work. Seffi carefully plucks a blossom from the tree. The flames scorch the edges of her leather gloves, But she comes away with a small white flower, the shape of a teardrop. When touched, it expands and darkens to the color of blood, before wilting and turning to ash. I've never seen anything like it. Nor do I particularly give a piss about the showmanship. It's too cold for that. A bloody red footprint blossoms in the snow in front of us. Zephy and her Valkyrie stay deathly still, arms outstretched, with fingers crooked in a gesture of defense against evil spirits.
It's just blood hidden in the stone, it's not real.
Still, the Valkyrie are overawed when more footprints begin to appear on the ground, leading us toward the god's mouth. They look to each other in fear. Even Sephi goes to her knees when we reach the stairs at the base of the temple's mouth. We mimic her, pressing our noses to the stone as the throat opens and out waddles a withered old man. Beard white, eyes violet and milky with age.
Ah, you are mad! Mad as crows to travel the stairs on the eve of winter!
His staff thumps each individual step in his descent, voice squeezing the lines for all they're worth.
Bone and frozen blood is all that should remain! Have you come to request a trial of the stains?
No, I rumble in my best Nagal. To take the trial of the stains now would do nothing for us. We would only see the gods when we received the facial tattoos. And surviving a test of the stained is something even Ragnar thought I was not prepared for. There's only one other way to bring the gods to me. Bait.
No!
We come to seek an audience with the gods.
At any moment, one of the Valkyrie could give us up. All it would take is a word. The tension works its way through my shoulders. Only thing that keeps me sane is knowing Mustang's on board enough with the plan to be bent on a knee beside me at the top of this damn mountain. That has to mean I'm not totally insane. At least, I hope.
So you are mad!
The violet grows bored of us.
The gods come and go, to the abyss, to the sea down below, but they give no audience to mortal men, for what is time to creatures such as them? Only the stained are worth their love, only the stained can bear the fever of their sight. Only the children of ice and darkest night.
Well, this is bloody damn annoying.
Only
a ship of iron and star has fallen from the abyss. It came with a tail of fire and struck among the peaks near the Valkyrie spires, burning across the sky like blood.
A ship?
The Violet is now utterly interested. As we supposed he would be.
One of iron and star.
How do you know it was no vision?
We touched the iron with our own hands.
The Violet is silent, mind sprinting to and fro behind those manic eyes. I'm wagering he knows that their communication systems are down, that his masters will be eager to hear of a fallen ship. The last sight he might have seen was my speech before Quicksilver shut everything down. Now, this lowly Violet, this eager actor, banished to the wastes to perform a mummer's farce for barbaric simpletons, has news his masters don't. He has a prize, and his eyes, when he realizes this, narrow greedily. Now is his time to seize initiative and gain favor in the eyes of the masters. How sad. The dependability of greed to make men fools.
Have you evidence? Any man may say he has seen a ship of the gods fall.
Hesitating, fearful of the deception I work, but disdainful of priests, Zephy produces my razor from her bag. It is wrapped in sealskin. She lays it on the ground in whip form. The violet smiles, so very pleased. He tries to snatch it from the ground with a rag from his pocket. But Seffi pulls it back with the seal cloth.
This is for the gods, not their whelps.
The priest ushers us through the temple's mouth, where we wait, kneeling on a black stone antechamber inside the mountain. The stone mouth grinds closed behind us. Flames dance in the center of the room, leaping up in a pillar of fire to the onyx ceiling. Acolytes wander through the cavernous temple, chanting softly, draped with black sackcloth hoods.
Children of the ice.
A divine voice finally whispers from the darkness. A synthesizer, like the ones in our demon helms, layers the voice, so it seems a dozen, sewn together.
You come with news?
I do, Sunborn.
Tell us of the ship you saw.
Another voice. This one less lofty, more playful.
You may look upon my face, little child.
Remaining on our knees, we glance up furtively from the ground to see two armored golds deactivating their ghost cloaks. They stand close to us in the dark room. The temple flames dance over their metallic god faces. The man wears a cloak. The woman likely didn't have time to don hers, so eager were they to attend us. The woman plays Freya, while the man is dressed as Loki, his metal visage like that of a wolf. Animals can smell fear. Men can't. But those who kill enough can feel the vibrations in that particular silence. I feel them now from Seffi. The gods are true, she's thinking. Ragnar was wrong. We were wrong. But she says nothing.
It bled fire across the sky, making great roars, and crashed upon the mountainside.
You don't say. And is it in one piece or lots of little itty-bitty pieces, child?
It is risky, saying we saw a ship fall. But I knew no other ruse that would draw the golds away from their hollow screens in the middle of a rebellion, past their security systems and grey garrison to meet me here. They're peerless scarred, trapped here on the frontier, as their world shifts beyond these walls. Once, this post would have been considered glamorous, but now it's a form of banishment. I wonder about what crimes or failings brought these peerless scarred here to babysit the wastes.
The bones of the ships litter the mountain, Sunborn.
I look back at the ground, so they do not insist I take away the riding mask that covers my face. The more groveling I do, the less curious I am.
Broken like a fishing boat laid upon mid-stern by a breaker. Splinters of iron, splinters of men upon the snow.
I think that's a metaphor the Obsidians would use. It passes muster.
Splinters of men?
Yes, men. But with soft faces, like sealskin in firelight.
Too many metaphors.
But eyes like hot coals.
I can't stop. How else did Ragnar speak?
Hair like the gold of your face.
The gold's metal masks remain impassive, communicating to one another over the comms in their helmets.
Our priest claims you have a weapon of the gods.
Seffi produces the seal cloth once more, body tense, wondering when I will dispel the magic of the gods as I promised. Her hands tremble. Both golds move closer, the slight ripple of pulse shields evident. I touch them and I fry. They have no fear. Not here, on their mountain. Closer. Closer, you dumb bastards.
Why did you not take this to the leader of your tribe?
Or to your shaman? The way of stains is long and hard. To climb all this way, just to bring this to us.
We are wanderers,
Mustang says, as Freya bends to look at the blade.
No tribe, no shaman.
Are you, little one? Then why are there blue tattoos of the Valkyrie on the ankles of that one?
His hand drifts to the razor on his hip.
She was cast out from her tribe for breaking an oath.
Is it marked with a house sigil?
Loki asks Freya. She reaches for the weapon's hilt in front of me. When Mustang laughs bitterly, drawing her attention.
On the handle, my good lady.
Mustang drops the facade, remaining on her knees as she strips off her mask and tosses it onto the ground.
You will find a Pegasus in flight, sigil of the House Andromedus.
Augustus?
Loki knows Mustang's face. I use their surprise and slip forward. By the time they turn back to me, I've snatched the razor out from under Freyr's hand and activated the toggle, so it is the curved question mark shape that has burned on hillsides, been cut into foreheads, and killed so many of their kind. The same they would have seen on the hollow displays as I made my speech.
Reaper.
Freya manages, pulling up her pulse fist. I hack her arm off at the shoulder, then her head at the jaw, before hurling my razor straight into Loki's chest. The blade slows as it hits his pulse shield, frozen in midair for half a second as the shield resists. Finally, the blade slips through, but it's slowed, and the armor beneath holds. It embeds itself in the pulse armor plate, harmless. Until Mustang steps forward and swivel kicks the hilt of the razor. The blade punches through the armor and impales Loki. Both gods fall. Freya to her back, Loki to his knees.
Mask off!
Mustang barks as Loki's hands wrap around the blade, sticking from his chest. She slaps his hands away from his datapad.
No comms!
Holiday strips the razor from the man's hip as his pulse shield shorts. I take Freya's razor from her corpse.
Do it!
Zephy and her Valkyrie stare, wide-eyed from their knees, at the blood pooling beneath Freya. I remove Freya's helmet from her head to reveal the mangled face of a middle-aged, peerless, scarred woman with dark skin and almond-shaped eyes.
Does this look like a god to you, Zephy?
Mustang snorts a dark little laugh when Loki removes his mask.
Darrow, look who it is. Proctor Mercury.
The pudgy, cherub-faced, peerless scarred who endeavored to recruit me into his own house at the Institute before Fitchner stole me away. When last we saw each other 5 years ago, he tried to duel me in the halls as my howlers stormed Olympus. I shot him in the chest with a pulse fist. He smiled all the while. He's not smiling now.
Oh, no.
As he stares at the metal in his chest.
No.
I feel a pang of pity.
Proctor Mercury. You have to be the least lucky gold I've ever met. Two mountains lost to a red.
Ha! Reaper! Oh, you have to be shitting me. But you're on Phobos.
Negative, my good man. That'd be my diminutive, psychotic accomplice.
Gory damn it! Gory damn it!
He looks at the blade in his chest, grunting as he sits on his haunches and wheezes out breaths.
How did we not see you?
Quicksilver hacked your system.
You're here for...
His voice trails away as he looks at the Valkyrie rising to gather around the dead god. Zephy bends over Freya. The pale warrior traces her fingers over the woman's face as Holiday strips off her armor.
For them? Bloody damn right I am.
Gory hell! Augustus?
Our old proctor turns to Mustang with a bitter laugh.
You can't do this! It's madness! They're monsters! You can't let them out! Do you know what will happen? Don't open Pandora's box!
If they're monsters, we should ask ourselves who made them that way. Now, what are the codes to Asgard's armory?
You'll have to ask nicer than that, traitor!
Mustang is deadly cold.
Treason is a matter of the date, Proctor. Must I ask again, or must I begin trimming your ears?
Beside Freya's body, Seffi dips her finger into the blood and tastes it.
Just blood. Not ichor. Not divine. Human.
I hold out Freya's razor for her to take. She flinches at the idea, but forces herself to wrap her fingers around the hilt. Hand trembling, expecting to be struck by lightning, or electrocuted like men are who touch pulse shields with bare hands.
This button here retracts the whip. This one controls the shape.
She cradles the weapon reverently and looks up at me, furious eyes asking which shape she should conjure. I nod to mine, trying to build kinship with her. And I do, if only in this martial way. Slowly, her razor takes the shape of the sling blade. The skin on my arm prickles as the Valkyrie laugh to one another, vibrating with excitement. They pull their own axes and long knives and look at me and Mustang.
There's five gods left. How'd you ladies like to meet them?
We drag the bodies of seven gods, two dead and five captured, behind us. I wear the armor of Odin. Seffi, the armor of Tyr. Mustang, the armor of Freya. All of which we pillaged from the armory on Asgard. Blood smears the stone of the hall. Feet slide and stumble as Seffi jerks one of the living golds behind us by his hair. Her Valkyrie dragged the rest. We return to the spires on a shuttle stolen from Asgard, which we slipped through silently, using Loki's codes to access the armory and drape ourselves in the panoply of war before seeking the remaining gods out. Two we found in Asgard's mainframe, leading a team of greens attempting to purge Quicksilver's hackers from their system. Seffi, with her new razor, claimed the arm of one and beat the other unconscious, terrifying the greens, two of which held up fists to me, a silent acknowledgement of their sympathy for the Rising. With their help, we locked the others in a storage room, as the two green sympathizers connected me directly with Quicksilver's operations room. We didn't reach Quicksilver himself, but Victra relayed news that Sevro's gamble worked. A little more than a third of the Martian defense fleet is under control of the Sons of Ares and Quicksilver's Blues. Thousands of the Society's best troops are trapped on Phobos, but the Jackal is hitting back hard, taking personal command of the remaining ships and recalling forces from the Kuiper Belt to reinforce his depleted fleet. The rest of the golds we located through the station's biometric sensor map in the lower levels. One practicing with a razor in the training rooms. She saw my face and dropped her blade in surrender. Reputation is a fine thing sometimes. The remaining two golds we found in the monitoring bays, shifting back and forth between the cameras. They'd only just discovered that the footage was archival from 3 years before. Now, all our gold captives wear magnetic handcuffs and are tied together by long pieces of rope from Seffi's griffin, all gagged, all glancing around at the spires, like we've dragged them into the mouth of hell itself. Obsidians of the spires flock to us in the halls, rushing from the deeper levels to see the strange sight. Most would only have seen their gods from a distance, as flashes of gold streaking over the spring snow at Mach 3. Now, we come among them, our pulse shields distorting the air. Our shuttle's pulse cannons melting open the huge iron doors which closed off the Griffin hangar from the cold. The doors melt inward, like the door on the Pax melted when Ragnar offered me stains. This is not how I intended to bring the Obsidians into my fold. I wanted to use words, to come humbly, in sealskin, not armor, putting myself at the mercy of the Obsidians, to show Alia that I valued her people's worth, valued their judgment, and was willing to put myself in peril for them. I wanted to do as I preached, but even Ragnar knew that was a fool's errand. And now I don't have time for intransigence or superstition. If Alia will not follow me to war, I'll drag her to it, kicking, screaming, like Lorne before her. For Obsidian to hear, I must speak in the only language they understand. Might. Zephy fires her pulse fist past my head at the doors leading to her mother's sanctuary. The ancient iron buckles, bent and twisted hinges screaming. We flow past an army of prostrate giants who clutter the cavernous halls to either side. So much strength, made frail by superstition. Once, when they were stronger, they tried to cross the seas, built mighty Nars to carry explorers across the oceans to seek out new lands. The carved monsters the golds sowed in the oceans destroyed each boat, or the golds themselves melted them from the sea. The last boat sailed more than 200 years ago. We come upon Alia as she sits in council with her famed 770 war chiefs. They turn to us now amidst large, smoking braziers. Huge warriors, with white hair to the waists, arms bare, iron buckles on waists, huge axes on backs. Black eyes and rings studded with precious metals glitter in the low light. But they're too stunned by the sight of the 300-year-old iron doors suddenly glowing orange and melting away to speak or kneel. I draw up before them, still dragging the corpses of the golds behind me. Mustang and Seffi hurl their captured golds forward, kicking out their legs. They sprawl on the ground and stumble to their feet, attempting beyond all reason to maintain some dignity here, surrounded by giant savages in the smoky room.
Are these gods?
I roar through my helmet. No one answers. Alia moves slowly through the parting warlords.
Am I a god?
I remove my helmet. Mustang and Seffi remove theirs. Alia sees her daughter in the armor of her gods, and she flinches back. Fear whispers over her lips. She stops near the five bound and gagged golds as they finally find their feet. They stand over 2 meters tall, but even bent and old as Alia is, she's a head taller than I. She stares down at the men and women who were once her gods, before looking up at her last daughter.
Child, what have you done?
Seffi says nothing, but the razor on her arm slithers, drawing the eyes of every Obsidian. One of their greatest daughters carries the weapon of the gods.
Queen of the Valkyrie,
I say, as if we had never met.
My name is Darrow of Lycos, blood brother of Ragnar Valaris. I am the warlord of the Rising, which rages against the false golden gods. You have all seen the fires that rage around the moon. Those are caused by my army. Beyond this land, in the abyss, a war rages between slaves and masters. I came here with the greatest son of the spires to bring the truth to your people.
I wave to the golds, who stare at me with the hatred of an entire race.
They struck him down before he could tell you that you are slaves. The prophets he sent told it true. Your gods are false.
Liar!
Someone screams. A shaman, with crooked knees and a bent spine.
You dare to speak?
He babbles something else, but Seffi cuts him off.
Liar! I have stood upon Asgard. I have seen where your immortals sleep, where your immortals rot and eat and shit.
She twists the pulse fist in her hand.
This is not magic.
She activates her grav boots, floating in the air. The obsidians stare at her in wonder.
This is not magic. This is a tool.
Alia sees what I have done, what I have shown her daughter, and what I have now brought her people, whether she wants it or not. We're the same cruel kind. I told myself I would be better than this. I failed that promise. But noble vanity can shine another day. This is war, and victory is the only nobility. I think that is what Mustang was looking for here, with obsidians. She was more afraid that I would allow my own idealism to let something loose that I could not control. But now she sees the compromise I'm willing to make, the strength I'm willing to exert. That's what she wants in an ally, as much as she wants a builder. Someone wise enough to adapt. And Alia? She sees how her people look at me, how they look at my blade, still stained with the blood of the gods, as though it were some holy relic. And she also knows I could have made her complicit in the gold's crime, could have accused her before her people. But instead, I offer her a chance to pretend she is just learning this for the first time. Lamentably, my friend's mother does not take the offer. She steps toward Sephi.
I carried you, birthed you, nursed you, and this is my reward. Treason, blasphemy, you are no Valkyrie.
She looks at her people.
These are lies. Free our gods from the usurpers. Kill blasphemers! Kill them all!
But before the first warchief can even draw their blade, Sephi steps forward, lifts the razor I gave her, and decapitates her mother. Alia's head falls to the floor, eyes still open. The woman's huge body remains standing. Slowly, it tips backward and thuds to the ground. Sephi stands over the fallen queen and spits on the corpse. Turning back to her people, she speaks for the first time in 25 years.
She knew.
Her voice is deep and dangerous, hardly rising above the level of a whisper. Yet it owns the room as surely as if she roared. Then, tall Sephi turns away from the golds, walks back through the gaggle of war chiefs to the Griffin throne, where her mother's fabled war chest has sat unopened for 10 years. There, she bends and takes the lock in her hands and roars gutturally like a beast as she pulls at the rusted iron till her fingers bleed and the iron crumbles apart. She throws the old lock to the ground and rips open the chest, pulling free the old black scarab skin her mother used to conquer the White Coast. Pulling free the red scale cloak of the dragon her mother slew in her youth, and hoisting high her great, black, double-headed axe of war called Throgmir. The rippling gleam of Durasteel catches in the light. She stalks back to the golds, dragging the axe on the ground behind her. She motions to Holiday, who removes the gags from the mouths of the golds.
Are you a god?
Sephi's tone is so different from her brother's. Direct and cold as a winter storm.
You will burn, mortal. If you do not release us, Aesir will come from the sky and rain fire upon your land. This you know. We will wipe your seed from the worlds. We will melt the ice. We are the mighty. We are the peerless Skard. And this millennium belongs to us.
Sephi slays him there with one giant swing, cleaving him nearly in twain. blood sprays my face. I do not flinch. I knew what would happen if I brought them here. I also know there's no way I could keep them as prisoners. The Golds built this myth, but now it must die. Mustang moves closer to me, her sign that she accepts this, but her eyes are fixed on the Golds. She will remember this slaughter for the rest of her life. It is her duty, and mine, to make it mean something. Part of me mourns the death of these Golds. Even as they die, they make these other, taller mortals still seem so much lesser. They stand straight, proud. They do not quake in their last moment, in this smoky room, so far from their estates, where they rode horses as children and learned the poetry of Keats and the wonder of Beethoven and Vollmer. A middle-aged Gold woman looks back at Mustang.
You let them do this to us? I fought for your father. I met you when you were a girl, and I fell in his reign.
She glares at me and begins to recite with a loud, clear voice the Aeschylus poem the peerless Skald use at times as a battle cry.
Up and lead the dance of fate. Lift the song that mortals hate. Tell what rights are ours on earth over all of human birth. Swift of foot to avenge are we. He whose hands are clean and pure, not our wrath do dread hath he.
One by one, they fall to Sephi's axe, until only the woman is left, her head held high, her words ringing clear. She looks me in the eye, as sure of her right as I am of mine.
Sacrifice, obedience, prosperity.
Sephi's axe sweeps through the air, and the last god of Asgard flops to the stone floor. Over her body towers the blood-spattered princess of the Valkyrie, terrible and ancient with her justice. She bends and removes the tongue of the female Gold with a crooked knife. Mustang shifts beside me in discomfort. Sephi smiles, noticing Mustang's unease, and walks away from us to her dead mother. She takes the woman's crown and ascends the steps to the throne, bloody axe in one hand, glass crown in the other, and sits inside the ribcage of the griffin, where she crowns herself.
Children of the spires, the Reaper has called us to join him in his war against false gods. Do the Valkyrie answer?
In reply, her Valkyrie raised their blue feathered axes high above their heads to drone out the obsidian chant of death. Even the war chiefs of fallen Alia join. It seems the ocean itself crashes through the stone hallways of the spires, and I feel the drums of war beating inside, chilling my blood.
Then ride, Hjelda, Thaurul, Vini, and Roga. Ride, Faldir, and Arona, and Bolga, to the tribes of the Blood Coast, to the Bleaking Moor, the Shattered Spine, and the Witch Pass. Ride to kin and enemy alike, and tell them Sephi speaks. Tell them Ragnar's prophets told true. Asgard has fallen. The gods are dead. The old oaths have been broken. And tell all who will hear, the Valkyrie ride to war.
As the world swirls around us and the ecstasy of war fills the air, Mustang and I look at one another with darkened eyes and wonder just what we have unleashed. Part 3. Glory. All that we have is that shout into the wind. How we live, how we go, and how we stand before we fall. Carnus au Bellona. For 7 days after the death of Ragnar, I travel across the ice with Sephi, speaking to the male tribes of the Broken Spine, to the blooded braves of the North Coast, to women who wear the horns of rams and stand watch over the Witch Pass. Flying in grav boots beside the Valkyrie, we come bringing the news of the fall of Asgard. It is dramatic. Sephi and a score of her Valkyrie have begun training with Holiday and me to learn to use the grav boots and pulse weapons. They're clumsy at first. One flew into the side of a mountain at Mach 2. But when 30 land with their headdresses kicking in the wind, the left of their faces painted with the blue handprint of Sephi the Quiet, and the right with the sling blade of the Reaper, folks tend to listen. We take the lion's share of Obsidian leaders to the conquered mountain and let them walk the halls where their gods ate and slept, and show them the cold, preserved corpses of the slain golds. In seeing their gods slain, most, even those who knew tacitly of their true condition as slaves, accepted our olive branch. Those who did not, who denounced us, were overcome by their own people. Two war chiefs hurled themselves from the mountain in shame. Another opened her veins with a dagger and bleeds out on the floor of the greenhouses. And one, a particularly psychotic little woman, watched with great malevolence as we took her to the mountain's data hub, where three greens informed her of a planned coup against her rule, showing her video of the conspiracy. We loaned her a razor, a flight back home, and 2 days later, she added 20,000 warriors to my cause. Sometimes I encounter Ragnar's legend. It has spread among the tribes. They call him the Speaker, the one who came with truth, who brought the prophets and sacrificed his life for his people. But with my friend's legend grows my own. My slingblade symbol burns across mountainsides to greet me and the Valkyrie when we fly to meet with new tribes. They call me the Morning Star, that star by which griffin riders and travelers navigate the wastes in the dark months of winter. The last star that disappears when daylight returns in the spring. It is my legend that begins to bind them, not their sense of kinship with one another. These clans have warred for generations. But I have no sordid history here. Unlike Sephi or the other great Obsidian warlords, I am their untouched field of snow, their blank slate on which they can project whatever disparate dreams they have. As Mustang says, I am something new. And in this old world, steeped in legends, ancestors, and what came before, something new is something very special. Yet, despite our progress with gathering the clans, the difficulty we face is massive. Not only must we keep the fractious Obsidians from killing one another in honor duels, but many of the clans have accepted my invitation for relocation. Hundreds of thousands of them must be brought from their homes in the Antarctic to the tunnels of the Reds, so they are beyond the reach of gold bombardment, which will come when the Golds discover what has transpired here. All this while keeping the Jackal dumb and blind to our maneuvers. From Asgard, Mustang has led the counterintelligence efforts, with the help of Quicksilver's hackers, to mask our presence and project reports consistent with those filed in previous weeks to the Board of Quality Control HQ in Aegea. With no way to move them without someone noticing, Mustang, a gold aristocrat, has conceived the most audacious plan in the history of the Sons of Ares. One massive troop movement, utilizing thousands of shuttles and freighters from Quicksilver's mercantile fleet and the Sons of Ares Navy, to move the population of the Pole in 12 hours. 1,000 ships skimming over the Southern Sea, burning helium, to set down on the ice before Obsidian cities and lower their ramps to the hundreds and thousands of giants swaddled in fur and iron, who will fill their hulls with the old, the sick, the warriors, the children, and the fetid stink of animals. Then, under the cover of the Sons of Ares' ships, the population will be dispersed underground, and many of the warriors to our military ships in orbit. I do not think I know another person in the world who can organize it as fast as she does. On the 8th day after the fall of Asgard, I depart with Seffi, Mustang, Holiday, and Cassius to join Sevro in overseeing the final preparations for the migration. The Valkyrie bring Ragnar with us on the flight, wrapping his frozen body in rough cloth and clutching him close in terror as our ship cruises just beneath the speed of sound, 5 meters from the surface of the ocean. They watch in awe as we enter the tunnels of Mars through one of the many sun's subterranean access points. This one, an old mining colony in a southern mountain range. Sun's lookouts in heavy winter jackets and balaclavas salute with their fists in the air as we pass into the tunnel. Half a day of subterranean flying later, we arrive at Tinos. It is a hub of ship activity. Hundreds cluttering the stalactite docks, taxiing through the air. And it seems the whole city watches our shuttle as it passes through the traffic to land in its stalactite hangar, knowing it bears not just me and our new obsidian allies, but the broken shield of Tinos. Their weeping faces blur past. Already, rumors swirl through the refugees. The obsidians are coming. Not just to fight, but to live in Tinos. To eat their food. To share their already crowded streets. Dancer says the place is a powder keg about to erupt. I can't say I disagree. The disposition of the Sons of Ares is dour. They gather in silence as my ship's landing ramp unfurls. I go first down the ramp. Sevro waits beside Dancer and Mickey. He slams me into a hug. The beginnings of a goatee mark his stoic face. He holds his shoulders as square as he can, as if those bony things alone could hold up the hopes of the thousands of Sons of Ares who fill the docking bay to see the shield of Tinos brought back to his adopted home.
Where is he?
I look back to my shuttle as Seffi and her Valkyrie carry Ragnar down the ramp. The Howlers are the first to greet them.
Greetings, sister.
Clown saying a respectful word to Seffi as Sevro steps past me to stand before the Valkyrie.
Welcome to Tinos. I am Sevro Abarka, blood brother to Ragnar Valaris. These are his other brothers and sisters.
He motions to the Howlers, all of whom wear their wolf cloaks. Sevro produces Ragnar's bear cloak.
He wore this to battle. With your permission, I'd like him to wear it now.
You are brother to Ragnar? You are brother to me.
Seffi clicks her tongue, and her Valkyrie pass stewardship of her brother's body to Sevro. Mustang glances my way. Seffi's generosity strikes me as a promising sign. If she were a covetous creature, she would have kept his body in her lands and given him an obsidian funeral pyre before burying his ashes in the ice. Instead, she told me she knows where his true home lies, with those who fought beside him, who helped him come back to his people. Mustang moves closer beside me as the Howlers drape Ragnar's cloak over his body and carry him through the crowd. The suns part for them. Hands reach to touch Ragnar.
Look.
Mustang nods to the thin black ribbons that the suns have tied into their beards and hair. Her hand finds my smallest finger. A small squeeze sends me back to the woods where she saved me, making me feel warm, even as we watch Sevro leave the hangar with Ragnar's body.
Go.
She nudges me his direction.
Dancer and I have a conference scheduled with Quicksilver and Victra.
She needs a guard, Dancer. Sons you trust.
I'll be fine. I survived the obsidians.
She'll have the pit vipers.
Dancer examines Mustang without the kindness I'm used to seeing in his eyes. Ragnar's death has taken the spirit out of him today. He seems older as he waves Narrow over and nods to the shuttle.
The Bologna on board?
Holiday's got him in the passenger cabin. His neck's still torn up, so he'll need Virini to take a look at him. Be discreet about it. Give him a private room.
Private? Place is crammed, Darrow. Captains don't even get private rooms.
He's got intel. You want him shot before he can give it to us?
Is that why you kept him alive?
Dancer looks at Mustang skeptically, as if she's already compromising my decisions. Little does he know, she'd have let Cassius die more readily than I ever would. Dancer sighs when I don't relent.
He'll be safe. On my word.
Find me later.
I depart. I find Severo slumped over Ragnar in Nikki's laboratory. It's a thing to hear of a friend's death. It's another to see the shadow of what they've left behind. I hated the sight of my father's old work gloves after he died. Mother was too practical to throw them away. Said we couldn't afford to. So, I did it myself one day. And she boxed my ears and made me bring them back. The scent of death is growing stronger from Ragnar. The cold preserved him in his native land. But Tinos has been suffering power outages, and refrigeration units play second zither to the water purifiers and air reclamation systems in the city beneath. Soon, Mickey will embalm him and make preparations for the burial Ragnar asked for. I sit in silence for half an hour, waiting for Severo to speak. I don't want to be here. Don't want to see Ragnar dead. Don't want to linger in the sadness. Yet I stay for several. My armpits stink. I'm tired. The scanty tray of food Dio brought me is untouched, except the biscuit I chew numbly. And think how ridiculous Ragnar looks on the table. He's too big for it. Feet hanging off the edge. Despite the smell, Ragnar is peaceful in death. Ribbons, red as winter berries, nestled in the white of his beard. Two razors rest in his hands, which are folded across his bare chest. The tattoos are darker in death, covering his arms, his chest, and neck. The matching skull he gave me in Severo seems so sad, telling its story, even though the man who wears it is dead. Everything is more vivid, except the wound. It's innocuous, and thin as a snake's smile along his side. The holes Aja made in his stomach seem so small. How could such little things take so large a soul from this world? I wish he were here. The people need him more than ever. Severo's eyes are glassy as his fingers glide over the tattoos on Ragnar's white face.
He wanted to go to Venus, you know,
he murmurs, voice soft as a child's, softer than I've ever heard it before.
I showed him one of the holovids of a catamaran there. The second he put the goggles on, I'd never seen anyone smile like that. Like he'd found heaven.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.